This time I devise the same phrase. It says from the word of God reminds us that a man that is born of a woman is of a few days and full of trouble. He cometh forth like a flock and is cut down, he feareth also a shadow and considereth not. The man and I shall live again. All the days of my appointed time will I wait till my change come. Thou shalt call and I will answer thee, and thou wilt have a desire to work of the lands. The days of 4 years are 3 score years and 10. And if my youth now strength be before 4 years, yet is our strength labor and sorrow. For it is soon cut off and we fly away. So teach us to number our days, that we may apply our hearts unto wisdom. This morning we're here to celebrate the life of Deloris Francis, and as we do, we ask to sing together with him, All the Way, My Savior.
Knowing the Lord that Jesus Christ is King and will die, that what you have resurrected, we too have hope for that resurrection. Today we ask for peace. And we pray, Lord, that the Holy Spirit is giving us that He may have comfort to us. Comfort to those who are mourning. Comfort to those who are grieving. Comfort to those who are feeling sorrow never. Again, God, we know that your God who desires the best for you people. So you will not leave us without God. Join our hearts, recognizing that you, Lord, will in no way stay away from this kingdom. Give us Lord in this program. Let the Holy Spirit fill this place. Let our hearts rejoice, knowing that you are our God, and we live awaiting your soon return. It is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Be good to you.
Thank you. We will not all sleep, but we will all be changed. In a flash, in a twinkling of an eye. At the last trumpet, for the trumpet will sound and the dead will be raised imperishable. And we will be changed, for the perishable must clothe itself with the imperishable, and the mortal with immortality. When the perishable has been clothed with the imperishable, and the mortal with immortality, then the saying that is written will come true. Death has been swallowed up in victory. Where, O death, is your victory? Where, O death, is your sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, He gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, my dear brothers and sisters, stand firm, let nothing move you. Always give yourselves fully to the work of the Lord, because you know that your labor in the Lord is not in vain. This is the word of the Lord, and I pray by saying, Amen.
Thank you. and when you train in the morning, she would have taken my children, my grandchildren to school, and then she would pick them up back with Julie. Julie, not just nowhere I go. And then she would pick us up back, and she would take care of my grandchildren, see to it that they are well fed. You should give them food, and she'll look after them and stay with them until we go out into the field over the rocks and valleys, over the hills and mountains. Sister Welch, Brother Welch, and Brother Oxy, and all of us, we would go out, and then she would go out, and when we come back, we tell them we'll be very, very hungry. And she would carry food from her yard for us, and we would have food to eat, plenty of food, and she would take care of the children and the grandchildren. Say to mommy, sit down over here, and nothing could eat the mommy in the house today. The mommy has to come out and stand up with me today here. She would take care of us, she would provide food for us, she would take care of the Bible workers. When they are working in the area and they are hungry, she would go home and she would cook food and she would carry it for us. And when we come back in the night, we'll get some nice warm soup in our stomach, and we would eat and we would drink and we would praise the Lord. And she would, yeah, I tell you, she was an excellent worker. I remember one day she served in the community service. She served as a deaconess. And out of many, 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 many times, there was one thing that stood out in my mind. It was one evening we went to visit one of our shopping. And when we went to visit the shopping brothers and sisters, we had a young intern pastor that was visiting with us. We went to serve this individual communion. And when we went to serve the communion, when we reached at the gate, the scent that lit us, it was worse than any colored children would stand. And we said to the young pastor, I said, Pastor, wait up here so let me and let us go inside. And when we went inside, you see, the lady, she was sick. When we went into the place was dirty. We see ants from outside, was coming from outside the house, but straight up on the bed where the lady was sleeping. Imagine, just imagine, from her head to her foot, she was covered with sewage things. Everything was dirty, down to the very center of the nature of it. And when we went in, we said, Sister Francis said, we don't need a pastor. And we went inside, and we took the broom. Sister Francis carried disinfectant, rag, towel, soap, everything we had done, Tintam, it always in Sister Francis' yard. And Sister Francis went inside, you see, and me and Sister Francis and Brother Francis, okay? And we went, Brother, and we don't have to go like Brother Francis, we don't have so many. And we said, we're going to the office, and we said, so we should have a woman get on Sister Francis and me and Brother Francis to clean up the place, and we sweep up the house. I would clean up the lady and wash up the lady. And she get back there and she pick up food and she went and she feed the lady. And after she feed the lady, we serve the lady communion. Sister Francis was a real disciple. She cared for the hungry. She cared for the needy. She cared for the widow. She cared for the fatherless. She cared for the motherless. She cared for everybody who she come across. Genuine Christian woman, brothers and sisters, she's a very, very, very good, nice, decent Christian woman. And I love Sister Francis. I was at home a few weeks ago, and when I was there, I was impressed in my heart to go out to call Sister Francis. I go and I visit her, I know that there is hope in Jesus. I know that this lady has lived a wonderful life, not only with church people, but with our families and all our friends and everyone in all our community. She lived a good, decent Christian life. She asked her nieces and her nephews, and she encouraged them to accept Christ as their personal savior from sin. And some of them, and they have accepted Christ, and they have been getting married and been serving in the right and proper way. Like what? She's a decent woman, and she keep a decent girl. And Michelle is one of them. Michelle is not here now. I won't see her. I'm here to shop at the kitchen. Yes. And she looked after our children. She looked after her family. She's a wonderful woman. And I am not weeping today as one walk no go. She take care of us. May God continue to bless her husband and bless the rest of family members and all our church friends and families. That when we come, we know for sure that by God's grace, we will live and reign with Sister Francis through the 60th ages of eternity. May God continue to bless you all and comfort you through the aid of the blessed Holy Spirit. Sleep on, my sister. See you in the first resurrection. God bless you.
Thank you. justly, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with our God. This is the life that Sister Frances lived. So we pay tribute to a beautiful wife, an enterprising woman. She was always working to ensure that the financial resources were there to take care of the needs of her family as well as other persons who were in need of assistance. She exhibited the qualities of the virtuous woman Solomon talked about in Proverbs 31. And I'm going to share a few verses that I think really depicts the person the Lord Christ was. She seeks wool and flax and willingly works with her hands. She's like the merchant ships. She brings her food from far. She also rises while it is yet night and provides food for her household and a portion for her maidservant. She considers a field and buys it. From her profits, she plants a vineyard. She girds herself with strength and strengthens her arm. She perceives that her merchandise is good, and her lamp does not go out by night. She watches over the way of her household and does not eat the bread of idleness. Charm is deceitful, and beauty is fleeting, but a woman who fears the Lord is to be praised. Ellen White, in her book Object Christ, Object Lesson, page 363, wrote, God is honored by wholehearted, cheerful service. He's pleased when we take up our duties with gratitude, rejoicing that we are counted worthy to be co-laborers with him. I believe God was pleased with the cheerful service Sister Frances gave. And it has been truly said, you can't give what you don't have. Clearly, Sister Frances was bubbling over with the love of God, and what was on the inside automatically showed on the outside. She always had a smile, and even during her illness, she was still pleasant. She gave what she had on the inside, love, joy, and peace. We will truly miss her. Sister Frances seems to have lived by this mantra. If I can help somebody as I pass along, if I can cheer somebody with a word or a song, if I can show somebody is traveling wrong, then my living shall not be in vain. If I can do my duty as a Christian ought, if I can bring that beauty to a world of love, if I can spread love's message that the Master taught, then my living shall not be in vain. Then my living shall not be in vain. My living shall not be in vain. If I can help somebody as I pass along, then my living shall not be in vain. Truly, her living was not in vain. In her quiet, humble way, Sister Frances impacted many lives, and your presence here today bears testimony to that fact. We thank God for her years of dedicated service to this church, which was motivated by her love for God. Her shining example of faithfulness, and based on her life as Christian witness, we believe she rests in Jesus, awaiting that trumpet call, when the musty old grave shall be opened as wide as before. We look forward to that day, that reunion with our beloved sister. And so, Brother Francis, family members, be comforted. She has done well. And praise God, she has done well. hoping we look forward to that lovely reunion when Jesus comes.
Amen. treasure and great oak. In the evening, it is cut down and withered. God has set our iniquities before thee, our secret sins in the light of thy countenance. The days of our years are 80 years and 10, and if by reason of strength they be 40 years, yet it is their strength, labor and sorrow, for it is soon cut off and fled away.
to feel that I'm going to take a look at you. So since I will give you, I will give you the people here. I'm not the last thing. I'm not going to be too long. I'm not the last thing when I look at her. I see that she was doing it. Because maybe, you know, when she sleeps, it's a funny feeling. But I did a really terrible job in our ministry taking care of her and not seeing her doing and not making any money. I said, Lord, I don't know. I am a human being. Who is that woman that is going after? To see and try to see about that upstairs. And I remember one day, you know, I went and I gave her a message that I think, you know, I can't tell her what she's happening. And I said to her, then, I have something to tell you. And she said to me, because when I tell you what I mean, I will say this man, a cup and dump from him that we have to buy the world. So happy that we knew you, I heard that you were. He said, talk to him, and he will hear that we will answer. He said, because this is the year, that's what we need to do, you don't look to him. And he said,
never crying again. Sister Francis Lance, a big human of the first tradition. But I stand here to say good morning to you, brother.
Afternoon.
The heights of great men reached and hit were not attained by some light, but they, while their companions slept, they toiled upwards through the night. Sister Francis and I are coming from a very long way. You understand? She used to do evening classes at the Bell's Gate All Age School. All the way from Lyman. Most of you here will know what I'm talking about. Because it's not Louisiana skills that you see. It's not an easy walk in those days. Our way of transportation was by jackass, donkey. Sister Frances didn't have that luxury. However, she made it morning and evening, morning up in the evening donkey, and she would never dare to go through driving. No, she comes all the way to home. Sister Francis and Polly, my sister, has been close friends. Close enough friends that when she passed, I had to directly call her and tell her, because she would always sometimes tell me the truth. I can't tell her the whole truth, because she said, when last you look today? And I said, you know, go stay this week, go to sleep. I'm going to lose the amount of time. Brother Francis, sometimes I have to call and ask you to relay the message from me, okay? This morning she called me at 9 o'clock and I said, and she said, David, you know, send the link to me now. I said, I don't get it, I'm going to send it. I'm going to say, when I came, I didn't really went to prevent the start screaming for things. No. However, I sent her the church link so that she could join whenever she's ready, so that she could see what is taking place. As soon as her baby said, listen, I'm swimming up. So I sent her baby from right on here. Sister Del has been a soldier that has not dead. She's just gone to rest. A good batsman stands at his feet. And even when he's not making any runs, brother Louis, he stays there and defends the wicket so that his companion can make some runs. If the match is about to draw and bad life is coming, he will signal to the umpire and say, it's bad life. If the umpire doesn't give, he stay there and play the next delivery. That's the word of a good batsman. Sister Del is born just like that. Today, she didn't just bat it wet, but she served her Lord during her time at the priest. She is a woman, a virtuous woman. I tell you, my wife deliberately could not be here today, but this is when she killed those chickens, she would give me one. And if you think that one was mine, do me a satisfaction, because I'm getting mine differently. She said, take this to the wife. And it's not just these ordinary chickens, but they are turkeys. She raised large chickens. When she killed the goat, she would see her parts. Some parts that I know dearly. And she knows that I know a big bean. So you know what she would do? She saved some bean for me as well. Sister Del has been a good friend. And if I was to tell you everything about Sister Del, you'd never leave here today. But the thing about her later days, when after came from England and realized that we were part of the same church, she gave me words of encouragement. And one of the things that she encourages me is that, Brother Price, we come from too far. We know everything about life, hardship. So there's nothing too tough for us to talk about. But you know one thing? Never allow yourselves to lose hope on God's kingdom. Because she told me that God has gone to prepare a place for us. And when she said us, she brought in her and said, not just for me and you, but for every one of us. And she said, take your sister, so she must get herself in the arms of God before it is too late. Why? They were good friends, and she knew that I am serving the Lord. So she would send messages to her friends and my family. I would say to you right now, because she can hear me, whatever I have to say to her, I would have to say it before the time of her passing. I can't say it to her now, but I can speak to you. The psalmist says, blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor standeth in the ways of sinners. You and I are no different from David. David said those words, and they are encouraging to me today. I don't know about you, but I can tell you, brothers and sisters, if you walk with the Lord, the result will be one that you will never need to regret. If I would speak to her, I would say, sleep on, beloved. Just sleep and take rest. When I looked at her a while ago, it seemed as if she was just smiling back at me. And I said, oh my, what a lady. But if her life that she lived was not one that I would recommend that you take pattern from, believe me, I would be saying otherwise this evening. You and I are in the land of the living, or repentance can right now. So I say to you, take charge. Take charge of your own life. Brothers and sisters, if you live for Christ, you will live again. But if you live for sin, you'll surely live in vain.
Lord, I stay. Good afternoon, everyone.
Good afternoon.
It's a long story coming from relationship with me and Auntie Ed, Mr. Francis. We always share a good relationship. I remember times when I was around 2 years of age and I went to Auntie Ed, I was feeling sick. So she had some simple babies in the back of the yard and she planned. So she said, look here, you're going to eat this, and then I'm going to the shop. You're going to take home. I'm going to see you after. So you can wash it down. That's it. I couldn't swallow that simple babies. It was so, you know, we share a good relationship and Auntie Ed is very genuinely family person. She's just a great individual. And Mr. Francis always supported me. Always supported me. But there's a lot more to say, but I'm a little bit speechless, so I'm gonna leave it right here. Thank
you.
Good afternoon, everyone.
Good afternoon.
I just want to welcome pastors, officers, members. Have a special welcome for Miss Marilyn Brown, Miss Sterling Brown. That's my co-worker from a long time from the Mineralites Primary School. Yes, welcome Mr. Omar Rocky. I just want to welcome the Francis family and both the Graham family. I welcome myself here as a half sister. Some of the family members who take time out from overseas to be here. Like my sister that came from Canada and I from Miss Deloris in the hospital. Everything in Mr. Francis Carly, I think I don't need to come as yet. The morning when she passed her, she said, I have to come now. But God knows everything. Yes, that's the only thing that we can do. I don't believe this summer.
Down here, you're burning heavy. On the roads are rough and steep. Sometimes your feet get weary. I'm so sure. But the brighter day is coming. When you stand.
Thank you. All to the view, just
I'm not quite sure if it was the convincing or the sweetness of the mango that made me smell when it was mango time. But every time I went there, my mango was ready for me. The message that I've chosen to share today is because of a church incident and what she said, the counsel that she gave. There was a situation at Canaanite Church, and I was holding my own. And she put me aside and said, "Pastor, you know what? Sometimes we need to look at things from a different side." And I said, "I hear you, Sister Francis, but..." And she was going in the car and she called to the window and said, "Yes, Pastor, sometimes we need to look at things from a different side." I dropped the message the first time she said it, but she thought it put it to say it again. And indeed, I did look at it from a different side. Not that what I was holding on to about the baby was wrong, but she realized that I need to look at a different side. So today, for the next few minutes, I want to share with us from Psalm 116, verse 15, under the theme, "Death from the Other Side." Death from the other side. The psalmist records from Psalm 116, verse 12 through 16, but the focal point and the object is on verse 15. But we need to look at what was said before and what was said after to get the meaning of verse 15, Brother Francis. The psalmist says, "What shall I render unto the Lord for all his benefits toward me? I will take the cup of salvation and call upon the name of the Lord. I will pay my vows unto the Lord now in the presence of his people." Then comes the poignant verse, "Precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of his saints." Then the psalmist says, "O Lord, truly I am thy servant and the son of thy handmaid. Thou hast loosed my bonds." Father, we open your words. Speak to us through them, we pray. Amen. Truly indeed, there are some things that were different from the other side. If you don't like crofty and crusty, then you may not eat a sweet sop, because the outside doesn't look good. But when you get a ripe sweet sop and open it, the inside is beautiful. Truly, if you look at the outside of what is known as an ugly, you may not eat it. But when you pick that ugly and go on the inside, you get something that is not only succulent but has a sweet flavor. Things look different from the other side. On the island of Man in Hawaii, there is a volcano that is often hidden by dreary gray clouds. But tourists have learned that a trip through the clouds is rewarded by the view from the other side. Mark Twain described, summarized over this volcanic mountain as the sublimest spectacle I have ever witnessed. Today, you can drive as a tourist the long twisting highway to the summit, taking care as you pass through the disoriented fog. But about 9,000 feet, you break out of the clouds, and when you reach the summit, it's a whole new world. The forbidden, barren, lava rock of the extinct volcano rests like a jewel
in the softness of soft white clouds. From above, the mysterious clouds look like the backs of 10,000 sheep racing across the sky. It's the same mountain that was there, and they are the same clouds, just seen from the other side. Sometimes the clouds look like faces, even when it is dark and dreary in the valley. The sun or the moon and the stars always shine above the cloud. The view from the other side is always there. I grew up with my grandmother. And I'm not quite sure how many persons here know the real crocus bat. I'm not talking about fighting bat. I'm talking about crocus bat. The brown bat? All right, some people know, some people don't know what I'm talking about. Lucille. All right, sir. And my grandmother used to make rugs out of crocus bat. We used to have to go together, scrap this material from the dressmakers around the community and take them back. Sometimes they were so heavy that one of us as little boys could not carry. We had to sling them back, or when I got bigger, I recognized it as sling, but sling them back. Right? And we'd come to grandma's house or granny's house and give her the bags of the scrapsticks. And she put the crocus bag, the blue sea bags, in different shapes. And she would have a bicycle spokes that was sharpened. And she would push the scrapsticks in the crocus bag that she cut and tied underneath. Out of the bottom didn't look too good because it had a maze of nuts, unraveled edges, loose strings, but at the same time, on top of that bag, it was the most beautiful sight. Heaven is like that. A little girl, while talking to her father as they took a walk one evening, looked up in the starry night and wondering, said to her father, "Daddy, if the wrong side of heaven is so beautiful, what must the right side look like?" The psalmist spoke of heaven and death from the other side. Not from man's point of view, but from God's point of view. The psalmist says, as he looked at those around him, whom he knew died with hope in the Lord, as he looked among those who walked through the valley of the shadow of death, he said, he exclaimed, "Precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of his saints." From this side for us, death is a time of sorrow. From this side for us, death is a time of loss. From this side for us, death is a time of defeat. From this side for us, death is a time of separation. But from the other side of heaven, on the other side of heaven, death is a time of release. From the other side of heaven, death is a time of reunion. From the other side of heaven, death is a time of rest. From the other side of heaven, death is a time of reward. Too often we think of death as coming to destroy everything for which we have lived. We should picture death as coming to save those whom we love. Many times we think of death as the end, or rather we should think of death as the beginning, of the continuation of a more abundant life, or resting until the resurrection morning. Too often we think of death as losing, but Paul describes death not as a loss, but as a gain. We think of death as parting, but death can be seen as an arrival. It's not the closing of the door of life, but rather it is the opening of the day to eternity. On this side, death looks like the end. You see, when we look at death from this side, it seems final. It appears to be the end of life, the end of relationships, the end of all that we have worked for, all that we have earned, all that we have made up. And in some aspects, that is true, because no longer will the loved one who die be able to enjoy the fruits of their labor. No longer will the loved one who die will we have a relationship with them. But then from the other side, death is not the end. Death is an entrance. Death is not the goal, but death is a gateway. Death is just the time before the beginning of a bright new life, eternal life for those who believe in Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Some anonymous writer comes nearest to describing this view of death in what he called a ship. He says, I am standing upon the seashore, a ship at my side, a spread of white sails in a morning breeze and stars for the blue ocean. She is an object of beauty and strength, and I stand and watch her until at length she is only a ribbon or a white cloud, just where the sea and the sky come to mingle with each other. Then someone at my side says, there she is gone. Gone where? Gone from my sight. That's all. She is just as large in mass and hull and spar as she was when she left my side, and just as able to be on her road of living freight to the place of destination. Her diminished size is in me, not in her. And just at that moment, when someone at my side says, here she is, she's gone, then all the voices ready to take on the glad shout, here she's gone, and that is dying. That makes him good, and that makes him really good, because Paul in the scriptures tells us that death is a departure. The word depart is a nautical term that means to weigh anchor and set sail. Rightly understood then, death is not the end for the child of God. It's just the resting place for the continuation of the eternal life that God had given to his daughter. So Walter Riley affirmed this biblical description of death when he wrote, and I quote, when men go down to the sea in ships, 'tis not the sea they go. Some add a pool, the mountain is gone, and thither they sail through calm and gale. When they went down to the sea they go, when souls go down to the sea by ship, and the dark ship's name is death, one moon and red and the night ship sail, though onward bound, God's world is round, and only a ship is death. And when I go down to the sea by ship, and death unfurls her sail, weep not for me, for there will be a living host, another coast to be conned, and cry all hail for the child of God. When death comes, it is a resting place for the child of God. The sign of death might bring grief and pain to the family members. For the child of God, this side of death might bring separation. But on the resurrection morn, all that will be glory. On the side of death, there is separation. But on the other side, there is a reunion. You see, the scripture describes death in various ways. It is spoken of as a departure. It is spoken of as being weighed down with an anchor. It is spoken of as setting sail, as an exodus, a going out, a dissolution, taking down what's earthly tent and moving on. But my favorite, one of the favorite, my favorite descriptions is when the scriptures say of Abraham, he gave up the ghost and was gathered to his people. Now, for anyone think that Abraham and anyone who dies is in heaven, let me give you a little enlightenment. You see the expression that is used in Genesis chapter 5 verse 8, gathered to his people, clearly implies something more that been carried back to the old family cemetery or been buried in a covered tomb or wall. It is a deeper and more spiritual meaning than that. Abraham was convinced of joining his deceased loved ones, a fellowship and personal association. Abraham looked for a city whose builder and maker is God. It suggests that he had become a part of the believers who believe that one day the Christian hope will be realized, who believe that one day the words of Paul in 1 Thessalonians 4:13-18 will be fulfilled, and the Lord himself from heaven shall descend with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Yes, the side of death, not the ugly, but the other side of death is a beautiful place when we along with those who die in Christ Jesus, when we along with those who will rise in the resurrection morn, when we along with those who will remain alive and be caught up together when they will die and are risen in the first resurrection, to be with the Lord in the air will be with our Savior, Jesus Christ. Now the story is told of an elderly Christian woman who was grief-stricken after the death of her daughter. To adjust, she boarded a ship from England to New York City to visit her other daughter. While at sea, a severe storm struck, and passengers were frantically racing towards lifeboats. The elderly Christian woman showed no sign of panic. A young man excitedly said to her, "Lady, don't you know we may sink and all will die?" "Young man," the woman quietly replied, "I have a daughter who is waiting for Christ in the resurrection morning. I have a daughter in New York who believes that there will be a resurrection morning. It doesn't make any difference which one I see. If we all die, we shall see each other." This makes heaven even a more wonderful place. The words of a poet who lost a child in death, he says, "I cannot say, and I will not say, that she is dead. She is just away. With a cheery smile and a wave of hand, she has wandered into a better land and left us dreaming how very fair it needs must be since she lingers there." Yes, this poet is saying that because his child died in a Christian home, that because as a child she believed that there's a heaven, she believed that there's a Jesus, it is not the child was not dead, the child was just resting until the beginning, resting until the resurrection morn, resting in the arms of Jesus, resting in the promises of Jesus, resting in the hope of Jesus. On the side of death, our hope may be shattered by our loved ones who die, but on death is that on this side death looks like a loss, but from the other side it is a gain. From this side it appears to be a defeat, but from the other side it is victory. You know the story very well. The sisters were in turmoil. The house was filled with people. They had sent to call their best friend Jesus, but he came 4 days late. When he came, the sister went to Jesus and said, "I know if you were here, my brother would still be alive." Jesus said, "He is not dead, he shall live." She said, "Yes, I know. I remember that Job says, my redeemer lives. Yes, I know that there's going to be a resurrection, Lord." And Jesus looked at her and said, "I am the resurrection and the life."
It was then that her perspective was changed. It was then that she saw the other side of death. You see, my brothers and sisters, you see, my friends, Paul says, for me to live is Christ, but to die is gain. The word gain is an economical term, it's a business term that means to make a profit. The bottom line is, death for the child of God is not a loss. It is a gain. For the Christian, it is a pain proposition. For the child of God, it is just a part of life. When you think you lose everything, but when you look at the other side, you realize that you will gain everything. Although I went to visit his old parishioner, reading. The old parishioner's favorite text. The young man, an old man rather, said as his pastor read the book of Revelation, there shall be no more death. Old man said, I will gain. There shall be no more sorrow. The old man said, I will gain. There shall be no more crying. The old man said, I will gain. There shall be no more pain. The old man said, I will gain. And finally, as the minister closed, the old man said, from jaws clenched in agony, he said, won't that be wonderful, Pastor? No more pain. Story of Richard Baxter. An old preacher who spent his last years in physical agony. His pain was intense by the fact that he was in prison for preaching the gospel. Shortly before his death, a friend visited with him, and a friend pulled up his chair next to the bed of Pastor Richard and said to the good old preacher, Richard, how are you doing? Richard replied, my friend, I am almost well. And then he died. And the old friend pondered what Richard must have meant. I am almost well. Then they cleared Pastor Richard's room. The nurse found a handwritten note with the words, I am almost well. And then the explanation to these words, I'm almost well because after I die, the next face I see will be the face of my Savior. I'm almost well because when I die, the next meal I eat will be with me, a meal with my Savior. I'm almost well because when I die, the next hand I shake will be the hand of my Savior. I'm almost well, but when I die, the next street I walk will be streets of pure gold. What is your view of death? At some point in time, in your life, is afraid to die. Well, the psalmist in Psalm says, weeping may endure for a night, but joy comes in the morning. The past few nights, those of us who live in the Spanish-Town area have heard gunshots in the night. But in the morning, it becomes peace and calm and quiet. For the past few nights, some people are afraid to drive certain areas in Spanish-Town.
struggled at the nights, but in the mornings, the streets became lively and lively. Again, what happens in the morning? Is that we shall be made new. We will no longer be in a sin-ridden world, but a place called heaven. What happens in the morning is that we will be able to view death from the other side. But don't wait for the morning. You can view death from the other side today. Sister Francis viewed death from the other side and accepted Jesus Christ as Lord and Master. And sure, if she was here, she'd probably say, I viewed death on the other side and was able to sing the song, oh, that will be glory for me, glory for me. When by his grace I shall look on his face, that will be glory for me. Today, I invite someone to view death from the other side, because precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of his saints. The question is, are you a saint of God? No, not the saints that you see in some churches. By saint, the scripture means, are you a child of God? Have you accepted Jesus Christ as Lord and Master? Only then will you, like Sister Francis, will be able to look at things from a different angle. Not from a human angle, but from the angle of Jesus Christ. The angle of life. Not just life, but the angle of eternal life. Won't you do like she did? Look at death from the other side and be saved. For Jesus is coming for his sins to die and are precious in his sight. Death from the other side.
Powerful word, what do you say? Amen. Great preaching, what do you say?
Amen.
From the other side, from the other side. I want to ask everybody to stand, with the exception of the family members. Please be seated. Let us pray. Father, we thank you for your promises. We thank you for your love that is awesome and amazing. We thank you, Lord, for your goodness and your protection and your providence. We ask, blessed and holy Jesus, God, your Father, and Mother, as the King of Glory comfort them, as the Good Shepherd guide them, as the Chief Shepherd hate them and have them, and as the Great Shepherd give them victory and deliverance. May the Spirit of God reign and rule in their hearts and minds. Grant them focus in the kingdom. We pray in Jesus' name.
All right, we are almost at the end of the program, and we thank you for your patience and your support. And we just want to give some instructions before we take this session. So in honor of Sister Francis' outstanding work in the Deaconate Valley, the Deaconate going to let us sing the first stanza at the same.